At this point, we will then categorize our diarrhea. This is an important table for you to be able to properly organize your thoughts. We have the category of the type of diarrhea, clinical conditions, and the important comments of each one of these. Osmotic diarrhea. As we get older, our need and requirement for calcium starts dropping. This becomes quite evident to us because as we get older, and if we were to consume the same amount of dairy that we maybe perhaps did once upon a time when we were young, there's every possibility that this is going to be rapidly evacuated from the colon due to the fact that as we get older, naturally speaking and physiologically speaking, lactase, in fact, becomes more and more scarce. Or you can have a patient who is actually lactase deficient. What does that mean to you? Remember that if you are reabsorbing your glucose from your intestinal lumen, you have to have it in the form of monosaccharide. The type of monosaccharide that becomes most important to you physiologically and then here pathologically would be glucose. Others include galactose as well. The combination of glucose and galactose gives you an interesting disaccharide, and that being your lactose. And lactose, of course, being the major carbohydrate that is contained in dairy. The reason that we're able to metabolize our lactose so very well is because of this very enzyme that we're seeing, lactase. Quickly, physiologically, and biochemistry, as we consume our carbohydrate or our dairy, we have amylase within our mouth, salivary. Begins a digestion, but obviously does not complete the full digestion. In the stomach further, we have acid and such, which then further breaks down a carbohydrate. By the time we get into our duodenum, first and second part, which is highly, highly concentrated with finger-like projections called microvilli, which then you can refer to as being your brush border. Literally, the finger-like projections are like your brush borders. This brush border then contains a type of disaccharidase. Another name for your lactase would be an enzyme that breaks down disaccharide. Be smart about how you approach your material. Therefore, a lactase is called a disaccharidase, which it does exactly as to what the name implies, which is to break down your disaccharide. Which one is it when we consume milk or dairy? Lactose. What if your patient is lactase deficient? Then you've left behind lactose, a disaccharide, back in your intestinal lumen. You've now created an osmotic force, which is then diffusing water out from your tissue or from the ECF and coming into the intestinal lumen, literally drawing water in. And take a look at how much volume you are losing. It's going to be large amounts of volume. And here you have, osmolar gap of being greater than 40. Stops with fasting. And here you might find the pH to be less than 6. Welcome to an osmotic diarrhea, lactose intolerance. A second type, a secretory type of diarrhea. The ones that you should be quite familiar with are those that are peptide-like. For example, the one type of tumor that produces too much serotonin in company would be carcinoid. And whenever you think about carcinoid tumor, you should be thinking about residing within the intestine. That's where the carcinoid tumor begins. So therefore, the type of stool that you're going to examine and what you're examining in the stool would be for your 5-hydroxyindole acetic acid or 5-HIAA. It's one type of secretory. VIPoma, the important acronym here that you will know or should know is WDHA. And WD stands for watery diarrhea. With all that diarrhea, your potassium levels drop like crazy. The H stands for hypokalemia. And then finally, the A stands for achlorhydria, but this would be a secretory type of diarrhea. Now, apart from tumors, and including gastrointestinal here, apart from tumors that also produce your secretory diarrhea, you can have certain organisms. For example, say that you drink contaminated water that contains the organism, the bacteria, Vibrio cholera. A Vibrio cholera then works upon your intestinal cell, and on the basal lateral membrane, it causes what's known as ADP, ribosylation, if you remember from biochemistry. That ADP rep oscillation is then going to insert or open up those chloride channels in the luminal membrane. And what is it going to do? You've heard of water or rice water stools. This is a secretory type of diarrhea. E. coli. There's something called ETEC. Remember from micro, E. coli could also result in a secretory type of diarrhea. You also have laxatives, such as senna. And all of this may result in secretory. Now here, yes, it's also a large volume stool. However, the osmolar gap is not going to be as significant as to what you find with osmotic diarrhea. That is important for you to pay attention to. And even though your patient might be fasting, it doesn't matter because this is a secretory biochemical activation. Just because you stop eating doesn't mean the diarrhea stops. That is very dangerous. Because what's your next step of management? That's a lot of fluid loss that the patient is experiencing. So you need to make sure that you do supportive therapy with IV fluids and company. Next, we have abnormal motility. And here, you should be thinking about dumping syndrome that we have discussed earlier. For example, during surgery, there's every possibility that the pyloric sphincter might be compromised. There's increased dumping of this chyme into the intestine. We talked about the symptoms where there might be things like hypoglycemia and the fact that there is going to be flushing and sweating and tachycardia and company. With all this dumping taking place with abnormal motility, you can only imagine that there is going to be diarrhea, in fact. Thyroid issues, increased motility. Thyroid issues, hyperthyroidism would cause more or less diarrhea. Whereas you see here in the paragraph, decreased motility, diabetes mellitus would slow things down because you might be suffering from diabetic neuropathy. In addition, what else may then decrease motility? What if you had SCL 70 and fibrosis? We talked about scleroderma also occurring up in the esophagus, but scleroderma, if it's a visceral type and it's systemic, may also cause fibrosis all over the place, including the intestine. Decreased motility, along with this hypothyroidism. So, for example, if you have Hashimoto and it's primary hypothyroidism, the patient may be suffering from constipation. The diarrhea due to bacterial overgrowth and syndrome of and decreased motility. Exudative. Example for this, inflammatory bowel disease such as ulcerative colitis, infection. Diverticulitis is exudative. Diverticulitis, we'll talk about diverticular disease, and we'll begin by looking at it by referring to diverticuli, then we'll go into diverticulosis, and at some point with diverticuli, with fecal lith accumulating in there, my goodness, just a matter of time before your patient goes into a state of diverticulitis. And that's pretty inflammatory, and that's pretty exudative by the time the stool then comes out. Here, once again, variable quantity. And with exudative, think of, once again, ulcerative colitis, which almost always begins in the rectum. And with all that ulceration taking place and in your stool, then you might be looking for blood, huh? Anorectal dysfunction, neurologic disease post-surgically. Here, it's small stool volume.